Welcome to Morning Song, everyone. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
All right. We're so pleased that you all are here. I first personally want to take just a moment and thank Landon. I have been gone for the past 2 weeks, and Landon has come in and taken over the band. And it's just, I was able to get texts, not always receive them, but I had the privilege of traveling to Greece and going on the journeys of Paul. So it's been an amazing 2 weeks. It was beautiful and incredible all in one. However, there's nothing like coming home and sleeping in your own bed and getting to worship with your own family. So this morning we're going to open with a new song. Rafe is going to lead us. It's from Psalm 34, Taste and See. We're going to allow you to be seated. We want you to try to join in on the chorus with us. The words are fabulous. Magnify the Lord with me. Come exalt his name together. Glorify the Lord together. So, Rafe, we're going to let you lead us, and then we'll ask you to join us in on the chorus.
All right. Let's worship God.
I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on him are radiant. You'll never be ashamed. You'll never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemies. The Son of God surrounds his saints. He will deliver them. He will deliver them. Lord with me, come exalt his name together. Glorify the Lord with me.
Come
exalt his name forever.
Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, blessed is he.
Sing that again.
Let us bless the Lord every day and night. Never ending praise. May our incense rise. Let us bless the Lord every day and night. Never ending praise. Rise, let us bless the
great and glorious God in whom we live and move and have our very being. You are the source of our breath, our love, our hope. To you we give praise and honor. We magnify your name, exalt you above all. So we bow our heads and our lives together today in humility, in worship, and in service. Before you, we open our hearts. Come, Holy Spirit, come to bless this time together. Fill us and lead us in the way of Jesus. Amen. Let us stand and sing.
Thank you. has quaked before. Moved by the sound of his voice, seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. It is well.
Let go my soul and trust in Him. The waves and wind
Friends, it is well with our souls because God's love is everlasting. Here in this place, when we're centered in God's presence, all seems good and right. And then we need just a minute to get out into life and realize we don't do what we want to do. And God's arms are still open, and He invites us to come close and be honest. Make confession to Him, and He will wash us clean and help us start again. I invite you to examine your hearts and let us pray together a prayer of confession, a prayer of new life. You'll find it in your bulletin. Join with me. Gracious God, we confess that we have longed too much for the comforts of this world. We have loved the gifts more than the giver. In your mercy, help us to see that the things we pine for are shadows, and that you are the substance, that they are quicksand, but you are the mountain, that they are shifting while you are the anchor. We ask for your forgiveness through the merits of Jesus Christ, worthy when we were not, sinless when we were sinful, glorious when we were shameful. It is through Him, the light of the world, we pray. O Lord, hear our prayers. In the name of Jesus, amen. Friends, the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Because we know new life in Jesus Christ, we have love to share. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Now let's share it with each other. Thank you. Y'all, this is so good. On Sunday in June, when some folks are gone and some of us have a more relaxed schedule, it's just good to chat it up, isn't it? I'm just so glad to see y'all today. I made it through this side of the room. I'll get back there afterwards, so don't y'all leave until you talk to me. So happy to see you. I want to just highlight a few things going on in church. You'll see this little purple sheet in your bulletin that lists out all kinds of cool stuff going on. The number one thing, there are two number one things. One is after church, there's lemonade on the lawn, I think up there by the sanctuary. Got a nod from over here, so yes, that's where it is. If you want to go get some lemonade and chat with some more folks, we got other Presbyterians up in the sanctuary now, so we can just have a little reunion up there on the lawn. Next Sunday is July 4th, God bless America, and we are having one worship service in the sanctuary, and there's not Sunday school next week. So just to kind of consolidate things, come and worship together with your church family upstairs. Also next Sunday, it's the first Sunday of the month, and so that means we are gathering donations for Total Ministries. You want to bring something that can help others, so check out their website, Total Ministries, or check out our church one. It'll link you to that as well. There'll be places to drop off your peanut butter, the paper products, stuff like that in the tower room and probably out here, I would imagine. We won't be out here. It'll be upstairs. So let me see what else is going on here in the life of the church. Two other things I want you to know about. One is they are taking recommendations for church officers. Presbyterians like to do everything very orderly. So we have a process for everything. And one of them is to elect deacons and elders in our church, church officers that help committees run and help things happen here in the congregation. And so we need your ideas for folks that would be willing to serve. You can nominate even yourself if you're up for it. Send in that email. You'll see the contact right there of how to connect so that you can be considered to be an officer or someone you know that might be interested in serving the church that way. The deadline is July 9th because you offer your name and then another committee goes through all the names and then it gets approved and all of the things. It's a long process I won't get into. But it works well. We have a lot of great deacons and elders doing the work of the Lord right here in this place, helping us all do it together. Two other options in the summer for you. One, you'll notice on your sheet here is a new idea. I love the name, The Perfect Blend. Isn't that cool? And they serve coffee, no less. So The Perfect Blend is twice a month back there in the large private dining room. Joanne and Lewis are gathering on Wednesday mornings for some coffee and a short devotion. So take note of that. One is coming up on June 30th, and the special guest is our own Holt Andrews. You can ask him every musical question you ever wanted to know. And he will be ready with the answer, man of much knowledge. Another idea is a summer women's Bible study just for 6 weeks out in the Arthur Center on Monday nights. I'm leading a group through a book called Following Jesus. We take a passage of scripture and talk about how it applies to our discipleship behind Jesus. It was a great group last week, lots of conversation, cross generations, very happy times. So if you're interested in that, I'm Ansley. Just let me know. We'd love to have you there. You can see a few other announcements there and on the back. Enjoy that, and if you have any questions after, come and find me, and I'll help you get the answers. There are no other announcements. I covered them all. So all the kids can come forward for time with Mr. Holt.
Yeah, boys and girls, come on down right here in front. We will get you something soft to sit on. Right over here in this corner, I think, were my instructions. So come on down, have a seat. Grab a mat. Welcome, everybody. There we go. Would you like one? There we go. Almost everybody. Certain tough kids need no mat. There. Everybody comfortable? Wonderful. Thank you so much for coming to see me this morning. I hope your summer is going great. I want to tell you a story today. It's a story about a birthday party. Yeah, so Carrie was turning 9, and for her birthday, she liked cake, but her very favorite thing was a pie. You know what kind of pie? She liked snickerdoodle. So she asked her mom to make her a snickerdoodle pie for her birthday. So her mom did. There were going to be 8 people at the birthday party. And so Carrie, who actually was pretty good in the kitchen already and helped her mom, decided that she was going to carefully, where did it go? cut the snickerdoodle pie into 8 equal pieces. So everybody at the party would have one. So there's my snickerdoodle pie. It only took me 30 minutes and a lot of ruined construction paper to create it. And so people started coming to the party, and everybody was there, and everyone was having a good time. And then the doorbell rang. And you know who it was? It was Carrie's grandpa. Her favorite person in the whole world had come to surprise her at her party. She was so excited. But then she got sad for a second because she thought, you know, gee, I cut that pie into 8 pieces, and now there's 9 people at the party, and what am I going to do about my grandpa, who I love more than anyone? But then she had an idea. She went to the cookie cutters in the kitchen. You know what cookie cutters are? How you put them over cookies to give them shape? She and her mom make cookies a lot. And she found a cookie cutter, and not just any cookie cutter. She found one shaped like a what? A heart. And so, with the help of her mom, right in the middle of the pie, the cookie cutter made a heart. And who was that piece of the pie for, you think?
Her grandpa.
Her grandpa, that's right, that's right. So her grandpa not only got the best part of the pie, but he also knew how much Carrie loved him because she had done the cookie cutter heart. So it's like that with God, boys and girls. If we give God our very best, there's plenty for everybody. Do you think there was enough pie for everybody else after that heart came out of the middle? Sure, sure. And everybody had an even better time. So let's pray. I'll start, and then please everybody pray after me. Dear God, help us remember to put you first. And when we do, there will be enough for everyone. Amen. Thanks so much for coming to see me. You can pop these things right back in here, and I hope you guys continue to have a great summer and do lots of fun things. Thank you, everybody. Well done. Listen now to the Word of God. Found in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 15. We want you to know, brothers and sisters, about the grace of God that has been granted to the churches of Macedonia. For during a severe ordeal of their affliction, their abundant joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For as I can testify, they voluntarily gave according to their means and even beyond their means, begging us earnestly for the privilege of sharing in this ministry to the saints. And this, not merely as we expected, they gave themselves first to the Lord and then by the will of God to us, so that we might urge Titus that as he had already made a beginning, so he should also complete this generous undertaking among you. Now, as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you also to excel in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I'm testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter, I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now, finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it's a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. For as it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Is there something special about Christian generosity? Or maybe I should put it another way. Is there something special about the kind of generosity that Jesus wants us to practice? There's not any question that generosity is part of our job description, if you will. But does that distinguish us from others? People of other faiths and people who claim no faith can, as we know, be wonderfully generous. Here's a statistic for you. Of the 50 largest cities in the United States, the leader in per capita giving by a mile is not Atlanta or Charlotte or Nashville. That's what I would have thought. It's actually, wait for it, Las Vegas. That's right. Las Vegas, Sin City, leads the nation in capital giving, in per capita giving. And I did learn, as I was researching this, with some pleasure, that as far as states go, South Carolina is number 5 in the country. Finally, we're in the top 5 of a national list instead of the bottom 5. But let me go back to the question. Is there something distinctive about the nature of generosity that we're being called to practice as disciples of Christ? If we look at today's passage on a surface level, well, we might say no. It seems to read a lot like financial appeals that we hear all the time. The church in Corinth had committed to collecting an offering, and Paul is encouraging them to follow through. And he uses some familiar, maybe I could even say secular, means of persuasion, like guilt. The church in Macedonia is a much poorer church than you, but they gave sacrificially. And then there's flattery. You Corinthians are great. Smart, faithful, enthusiastic, loving. Now followed up with some cash. And then there's the soft sell. I'm not ordering you to do anything. I know you'll search your hearts and come up with the right answer. And I'm not even asking you to give sacrificially, even though the Macedonians did. Just give according to your means. Honestly, change the names and places, and you could plug all this into a lot of financial appeals, including right here in this place. I've heard stuff like this my entire life. I bet you have too. Now, that is not to say that Paul said anything to the Corinthians or is saying anything to us that's untrue. There are people out there like the Macedonians whose giving spirit should make us feel a little ashamed. And certainly, we are all great, faithful, smart, enthusiastic, amazing people, not to mention good looking. I mean, look around. And it may be self-serving, but I do agree with Paul that we are not necessarily called to live in the wilderness, put on a hair shirt, and eat locusts and wild honey. Some of the most beloved figures in the Bible were well off by the standards of their time. Think about Abraham or Isaac or Jacob, King David. But the fact that Paul was a practical man making a practical appeal shouldn't distract us from a more profound truth. What Paul really wants the Corinthians and us to understand are deeply important aspects of the Christian heart. Listen again to verse 12. If the eagerness is there, then the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. We've all heard often that it's not the size of the gift but the spirit behind it that counts. And Paul is saying this, but he's saying a lot more. He's saying that the willingness to give is part of the spiritual condition that is Christianity. Generosity is something that we do as Christians, and it often is going to yield results that we can quantify. But in Jesus and Paul's world, that's the symptom. In Jesus and Paul's world, generosity is a chronic spiritual condition that's a part of who we are. A willingness to part with resources is one element, but it goes beyond that. At its heart, Christian generosity is an ongoing sensitivity to human need and a willingness to find a way to help. An ongoing sensitivity to human need and a willingness to find a way to help. If I gave you a few moments, I am sure you could conjure up your own examples of this kind of spirit. Right now, I'm going to offer this one. If you were to go to Cross County, Arkansas, and get a property map, you'd notice that most of the county is farmland. And if you were to take that map, hop in your car, and start to tour the farms, in some of them, you would notice something curious. Churches situated at the corners of the property. Well, some of those farms belong to my dad. He deeded the corners of his farms to congregations who needed a place to put up a church but didn't have the money to buy the land. I didn't even learn about this until he was into his 80s, and I didn't hear about it from him. He never said a word. In fact, I don't recall Dad ever saying a single word to any of us about generosity. He didn't have to. It was a part of who he was. He had something he thought someone else needed a little more than he did, and so he gave it away. It sounds effortless, and I think for Dad it was, but perhaps for some of you, like for his son, it doesn't come quite so easily. When I give a gift, sometimes I find myself thinking not about what someone else has gained, but about what I've lost. And I'll confess that sometimes when I get reminders from the church about the pledge, our pledge, and I see the number, it's hard not to think about other things we could be doing with that money. This is the kind of feeling Paul would want me to get rid of. And it's the kind of feeling the Macedonians in our scripture passage did get rid of. The Macedonians, unlike the Corinthians, were dirt poor. But for this collection, which was for the also very poor mother church in Jerusalem, they gave well above their means, so far above that Paul was afraid they weren't keeping enough for themselves. And he actually considered asking them to take some of it back. But he didn't. And a story a pastor told me years ago might help explain why. In this pastor's congregation, there was a retired couple of very, very modest means who he learned were giving 50% of their annual income to the church. And so he decided to pay them a visit that, as he put it, was unlike any stewardship visit he had ever made before or ever expected to make again. And he told them that while he was deeply impressed and moved by their gift, would they consider reducing it so they'd be sure to have enough for themselves as the years progressed? And their reply went something like this: "The future will take care of itself. Please don't deny us the joy and the privilege of giving." Now, some people would listen to the story and think about the 50%, the number. And Paul would say, yes, that's an impressive number, but that's not the final point. The spiritual condition of this couple, where giving was a joy and a privilege, and it was just a part of who they were, that's the point. And this leads us to another thing that I think Paul would like us to understand. Every Christian, no matter how much or how little that person might have, is a giver. The very poor Macedonians were givers, and he was encouraging the less poor Corinthians to be givers. There's an ancient Jewish festival called Purim, and on the day of the festival, one of the traditions of Purim is that every single person, no matter how rich or how poor, finds something to give away to someone else. It's about an equality. Not about an equality of means, everybody having the same amount. It's about an equality of spirit. And It's about an equality of dignity. You know, for people who've been blessed with resources, like most of us, there's a danger. And the danger, if we give some of it away, is that we start to think that we who have more, give to them who have less. And then before we know it, there's us, and then there's them. The Christian concept of generosity leaves no room for us and them. There's only us, and everyone is giving out of their time and talent, resources, whatever they are. And so there's an equality of spirit and an equality of dignity in the Christian community. And the true gift is not a thing or a check, it's the spirit. The amount of money and time, resources, those are manifestations of the spirit, and they're important, but in the end, really, they're details. Then there's another step. If every Christian is a giver, then every Christian is also a receiver. Really, they're two sides to the same coin. Listen again to Paul. This is in verses 13 and 14. It's a question of balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. Now, this is important. The balance Paul is talking about here, it's not a balance, it's not talking about a balance of material resources. He's not saying to the Corinthians, you have money now, and they don't, but maybe someday the situation will be reversed. What he's instead saying is, you're giving them money which you have and they need, but they as the mother church in Jerusalem, gave you Christ, which they had and which you needed. So for all of us, what we have and what we need are a little different. And Christian generosity is about sharing what we're able to offer to others, yes, but it's also about receiving what we need from others. Some of you might remember that Marcia's mom passed away a couple of years ago. In the last months of her life, she had two very special caregivers, Sherry and Pam. Thankfully, she had the resources to pay them, which they needed. But they had something she needed, something beyond the reach of any contractual arrangement, a personal, pastoral, caring, spiritual quality. You know, not all of us are going to need financial help, but at some point or another, we all need that kind of gift. And you can maybe pay people to be nice to you, but real Christian care can't be bought. It can only be given away. So, in God's kingdom, not only is everyone generous with their particular gifts, whatever they are, but everyone is willing to receive from others. Maybe, like me, you're a little more comfortable with the giving part than you are the receiving part. My understanding growing up was that I was to be a net asset to the world rather than a net liability. And that's not a bad thing to aspire to. But if we start to think only about what we can or should be doing for others, we can begin to wall ourselves off from gifts that we need to receive. The flip side, the other side of the coin of a generous spirit, is being open to and trusting in the generosity of others. Several years ago, I spent most of the summer in a chaplaincy program. The chaplaincy program, in fact, just down the street at Spartanburg Regional. And among the many, many things I learned, I quickly realized that there are two aspects of hospital life that are universally true. One is that everyone, no matter who they are, has to learn to wait. That's actually probably another sermon. But the other is that no patient wants to be there. Seems obvious. One of the jobs of the chaplains, of course, were to see how our guests were adapting to their stay. And I noticed something. The more nervous and suspicious a patient was, the more he or she put up walls, the more miserable. And conversely, the more that they trusted in the doctors and nurses and the staff, And the more grateful they were for the care they were receiving, the happier they were. I attended as a chaplain 21 deaths that summer, and among those that stand out was the very first one, and not just because it was the first. A woman had gone into cardiac arrest unexpectedly, and the code team arrived quickly, but they were not able to revive her, and she passed away. I was called to be with her husband. Trying to comfort him, I said something like, "I want to assure you that everything that could have been done to save your wife was done." And he looked up at me, looked a little puzzled, and he said, "Oh, I know that, and I'm very grateful." Wow, what a statement in that moment. What a generous receiver of care, and what a giving spirit to offer a response like that. So, is there something special about the Christian spirit of generosity? Paul would say, yes, absolutely. First, Christian generosity is, before anything else, a spiritual state that flows through people who know they've been redeemed. It can manifest itself in concrete ways, and there are ways we can and need to add things up. But if the numbers are a manifestation of the Spirit, and if the Spirit is there, the numbers are probably going to work out. Second, everyone is a giver. The type and the quality of the gifts will be different, but if everyone is willing to share their gifts, then all needs are going to be met. Third, every gift is valuable. In fact, every gift is vital. Paul said it wonderfully again. This is in 1 Corinthians. The human body needs eyes, hands, ears, mouth, nose, and on and on. No body part is unimportant. Every part is needed for the whole body to function, just as with the body of Christ, just as with the Christian spirit of generosity. Every gift is vital. All gifts are needed for the body of Christ to work as it should. And finally, every Christian is self-aware, which is another way of saying that everyone is a receiver. Because to know ourselves is to know that we need help. That's the root of why we confess our sins, isn't it? To acknowledge that our own resources are not sufficient and to ask for help. Humility before the Lord and before each other, it makes us better receivers, but it also makes us better givers. Now, if this all sounds like a pleasant fantasy to you, let me assure you, it's not. You actually don't have to look any further than the Faith Initiative to Combat Child Poverty, right here in Spartanburg, that this church, First Presbyterian, has done so much to get off the ground. An organizing principle of the Faith Initiative is that child poverty is a problem for the entire community, and it will only be solved by the entire community working together. There's a recognition that every kind of human gift is going to be needed, and that everyone, no matter where they live, no matter the zip code, no matter the resources, has to help, each in his or her own special way. It's the gospel in action, right here, right now. Or, check out the work in the Dominican Republic that our church has done, and maybe consider going on February's mission trip. You're going to see what nearly three decades of a true partnership with our friends there has accomplished. Take a look at both of these, and then let's all take a look at ourselves. I've said this is not about numbers, but I'm going to leave you with two of them. The first is the biblical standard of giving, which most of us know is 10%. The second is the average annual gift of American Christians, 2.5%. The difference, it's not in the bank, it's in all of our hearts. Are there gifts you have, time, talent, resources, that are just waiting to be unleashed? Are there perhaps connections between God or with each other that are waiting to be made? Take Paul's advice to the Corinthians and go for it. I promise you, you won't be sorry. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Having heard God's word proclaimed, let us stand and state what we believe, saying together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Two other things you need to know of in the life of the church. We had a birth this past week on June the 23rd. Let me get the date right. Yes, we had a baby girl born into our church family, Lida Suzanne Brown, who's the daughter of Megan and Hunter Brown. She was born Wednesday, June 23rd. She joins her siblings, Walt, Edith, and Harry. And her grandparents are Susan and Wayne Cease. So y'all might remember Megan Cease when she was growing up here. So we are so glad to welcome baby Lida to our church family. Also, this past week, we had another member of our church join the church triumphant, Liz Chapman. Her full name was Nina Elizabeth Siphon Chapman. She passed away on Tuesday, the 22nd. I'd ask you to remember her family in your prayers and give thanks to God for her life. Let us join together in prayer now. Wondrous God, through your word and spirit, you lead us on a path of eternal life, peace and joy, love and faith. Here we can see beyond ourselves and find meaning and connection with you, O God, and so with one another, our brothers and sisters in Christ. You bring us together in our searching, in our conversations, in our quiet, in our worship, in our prayer and service. And as we praise you, as we seek to follow you together, we give you thanks, O God, for gathering us as your people. So we set anew our aim to love you and to love our neighbors. We love best when we see one another with your eyes and come together before you. So now together we bring our concerns to you. O God, we pray that you would minister to those in discomfort, those who are hurting from illness or circumstance. We pray that you would heal their pain and plant hope in their spirits. Holy God, minister to those who are in emotional or mental or spiritual anguish. Give to them relief and direction, we pray, a sense of your presence with them. Restore their souls. Holy God, minister to those struggling with decisions, with relationships or setbacks. Send your light and wisdom. Help them to find their way through the waters. Give them courage to follow where you lead. You, O God, are able to do more than we can even imagine. You are the living God at work in and around us, so we lean on you. We entrust you with our lives and with those we love. Our eyes are bright with expectation of the grace you will bring. We rest in your embrace and sense the balm of your Spirit wash over our souls as we release our worries. Your peace meets us. You weave a ribbon of grace through us as your people. Help us this week, O God, not to wander from you and this sense of rest and peace, Settle us here, ground us here, breathing in grace and knowing love. Green pastures, still waters, cups overflowing, goodness and mercy, our whole life long in your care. So in the saving name of Jesus, we pray, and we pray with the words that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, as Holt was directing our eyes to think about the Dominican Republic and other mission initiatives, what came to my mind was this very room and how our spirits, spirits of generosity, allow us to share our gifts right here as the kids gather, as the parents shake hands and we pat each other on the back. You sense the blessings blessing each other. So let us examine our lives and open our hands and share what we've got to make the world better. Let us stand and bring our offerings to God as we sing.
As you stand for our offering this morning, we were reminded that we will not be moved when the earth gives way because the risen one has overcome.
Darkness fades into new beginnings as we lift our eyes to a hope beyond. All creation waits with an expectation to declare the reign of the Lord our God. We will not be moved when the earth gives way. Gives way For the risen one has overcome. And for every fear, there's an empty grave. For the risen one has overcome.
Sing that with us one more time.
We will not be moved when the earth gives way.
Let us pray. Lord, your generosity overwhelms us. All we have is a gift from you. As we give back from the abundant blessings you've bestowed on us, may they be acceptable in your sight, O God, you who are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Friends, it's our duty as Christians to give of ourselves, and sometimes that's just what it feels like, duty. Paul understood that, but we were meant for more. We were meant for our giving, like everything else in our Christian lives, to bring us delight. So, hear this benediction from Psalm 37 from King David. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Delight in the Lord, and he will satisfy all the desires of your heart. Go in peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.